The sun has an 11-year solar cycle. We have passed probably through the maximum of the current solar cycle, but we are still in the active phase. It is ebbing, but we are not terribly far past the peak. And what we are seeing is solar activity that is causing unusual levels of terrestrial disturbance for the ejections coming from the sun.
Given the size of the coronal mass ejections coming from the sun, the Earth is being affected more than you would expect, more than such sized CMEs, coronal mass ejections, would have caused in times past.
Right. Now, some of the effects have to do with human technology, which has moved on. So there was a major disruption in 1859, the year everything happened.
It's crazy.
Called the Carrington event. And the Carrington event was noticed the correlation between a flash from the sun and disruption on Earth was noticed by the astronomer Carrington, which is why it bears his name. The disruption down here on Earth amounted to basically telegraph operators being shocked at their stations, the telegraph system going down, telegraph operators being able to send messages even though there was no power in the system based
dose
on
in the machine.
Induced currents. I believe some telegraph stations caught fire. Anyway, it was a telegraph nightmare, right? But it wasn't a nightmare in many other regards because the world was not an electric place yet, right? So the one serious electrical system we had went nuts, but by and large, you know, there were auroras and other things. So that's my point. There's a technological aspect of impacts down here on Earth, and then there's a natural impact, things like auroras. And the aurora situation is becoming intensified. We are seeing auroras farther south than we should be for the given level of storm on the sun, which I will get to the reason for in a second. But we are also much, much, much more vulnerable to the coronal mass ejections and other things that contribute to the solar wind because our electromagnetic field is decaying.
That is the Earth's, the geoelectromagnetic field is decaying.
Is decaying, right. And that is effectively,
which is also cyclic.
Yeah, but on a time scale where we are not going to see it return. We are going to watch it continue to decline, which means that our vulnerability is going to continue to go up while the electrical and now electronic nature of Earth is only increasing. So our dependence on those electrical systems is profound, and the danger that they pose to us if they go down is utterly profound. So we are...
So when you say the danger that they pose to us if they go down is profound, I'd like you to spell out, you know, so when I hear that, I hear, well, we're suddenly not connected and we mostly don't know how to do anything for ourselves anymore. And the fact that we're not connected, we can't just like pull out a map. No one has maps anymore, that sort of thing. But then there's also systems that actually take input in order to maintain neutrality, like reactor cores and nuclear plants.
Right. So what Heather is alluding to is that the generation of nuclear reactors that we have, civilian nuclear reactors that create power, is such that they require active cooling in order not to melt down. And the fuel pools in which the fuel that is spent, that has come out of these reactors, the pools in which they are kept cool, require a constant infusion of cold water. And if that cold water stops flowing, the water will boil off very quickly and the spent fuel rods will catch fire and all of the radioactive isotopes will be released into the atmosphere in the form of smoke. All of this is very, very bad. And there are reactor designs, so-called fourth generation reactors, which fail safely, but we're not using them. And so anyway, we have a...
And even if we started, we still have all of the previous ones that need to be maintained.
Yes, I would say whatever your position is on nuclear, and I've come around to the idea that nuclear may be necessary, even fission. Fusion I'd be thrilled by.
Sure.
Fission, there are forms of reactors that I think might be very useful, thorium, liquid salt. These are these are designs that fail safely and I believe could be used to very good effect. But the kinds of reactors that are currently generating power can't be rendered safe. There are requirements for them to have, I think it's 2 weeks of diesel fuel for generators in order to keep them cool, which is good. But we saw, for example, in Fukushima that the generators were immediately overwhelmed with seawater as a result of the tsunami that caused the triple meltdown.
And if you've got a continent-wide grid failure, 2 weeks of diesel isn't going to cut it.
Right. So you could imagine, and in fact, I wrote an article, and it turns out to have been 2019, about basically Unheard. The publication asked me to write on this topic, and I decided to write a scenario of how a solar storm could result in human extinction. And I was shocked, actually, at how easy it was to get from A to B. Right. It almost wrote itself.
Yep.
And that was long before I understood the full extent of the danger. Right. This was just simply the fact that the Earth flings off these coronal mass ejections. They pose a danger to the grid, and the grid is constructed in such a way that our sense that if it goes down, it will be back up in a few days is just simply not accurate. Mm-hmm. But anyway, now I understand a great deal more about what's going on the solar side of this. And it's far worse than I had suggested. Do you want to put up a picture of the that article? Oh, unfortunately, it doesn't. You want to scroll? No, back the other way. Yeah, there we go. How the sun could wipe us out. So anyway, we will link that article. But what we have is a situation where the Earth's magnetic field is degrading. The sun goes through these 11-year cycles. The sunspot cycle, a sunspot can eject a flare. Not every flare is accompanied by what's called a coronal mass ejection. But many of them are, and those coronal mass ejections can be small, they can be large, they are usually just by chance pointed away from the Earth. But when a sunspot cluster is facing the Earth and it releases a coronal mass ejection, that coronal mass ejection hits the Earth, it causes the shields of the Earth, the electromagnetic field, to weaken suddenly. So in other words, that electromagnetic field takes a hit. It absorbs this coronal mass ejection, protecting us, but it also becomes weak in the immediate aftermath of this hit. There are other things that can contribute to that weakening. In the case of what happened on somewhere between the 5th and the 7th of November, what we had were some not very large coronal mass ejections, but they hit us in the immediate aftermath of a coronal hole stream. This is a cool, thin spot in the surface of the sun that is basically putting out solar wind, like, you know, a leak in a beach ball. So we were being swept by the solar wind at the same point that these coronal mass ejections hit us, and so they did more disrupting than they would have been expected to. Based if they had been in isolation. Now, there was briefly a moment back November 6th when the coronal hole stream had weakened the electromagnetic field. The coronal mass ejection from the M-class flare hit us, and there was concern about whether or not this could result in the grid going down. It wasn't a super high chance. It was down in the single digits, according to Ben Davidson. But nonetheless, single digits is still frightening, right? Mm-hmm. You know, a 1 in 20 chance of the grid going down and not coming back up is nothing to sneeze at. But the danger quickly lessened because, ironically, the speed of the coronal mass ejection was greater than the folks who track these things had expected. So while ordinarily speed is a negative factor, it puts you in more danger, the fact that it gave room between the coronal mass ejections hitting us actually lessened the danger because it gave the electromagnetic field time to recover. So there was brief concern, and then that concern evaporated. And then the sunspot cluster that is putting out these coronal mass ejections rotated even more directly facing the Earth, and we got another series, including X-class flares, which are a class above M-class flares. And things, again, have gotten scary. In fact, yesterday, which was the 11th, we had a... solar storms are graded, and we had a G4 storm heading towards G5. G5 is the top class and very dangerous. And so people will have heard that auroras were seen as far south as Florida and Texas. That shouldn't be happening. This was the result of a cluster of CMEs, two of which, the first two, joined together and delivered a much bigger wallop than either of them would have done on their own. And now we have the largest of the CMEs due to hit tonight. Now, there's a lot of modeling that goes into knowing how big a hit to expect. And there's none of it is highly accurate, because as you imagine, if you were to fling a cloud of dust at some object, the cloud of dust could be very dense, but it's possible that the object would get hit by a section of the cloud that was not dense at all, or the inverse can happen, where you could have a cloud that's not very dense but one patch of it is. So there's lots that we don't know until it hits. We don't know the timing of it. We don't know how two bursts will interact with each other. All of these things have an impact on how severely the Earth systems will be disrupted, if at all.
Just a second.
Yep.
So Ben Davidson is the person you keep referencing.
Yep.
who is doing a lot of the heavy lifting here. But it's not just him.
Yep.
Right. Can you show my screen, or is my computer not playing nice?
There it
hey, look
is.
At that. So this is NOAA, NOAA's site. That's the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, government, U.S. government site. Specifically, their Space Weather Prediction Center, what they've got on their site right now. It's real time. That they've got solar wind speed, solar wind magnetic fields. I don't even know what R, S3, and G4 are, so I don't know how to refer to those categories. They've got all the things here, and they're not always going to agree in interpretation with other observers like Ben Davidson, who's on Twitter at Space Weather News, I think. But you should find the empirical data insofar as it is measurable. That is to say, we're obviously using remote tools, remote instruments that need to be calibrated and such, and different tools will measure slightly different amounts of things, but you should find empirical measurements basically agreeing with one another. And NOAA, like Ben Davidson, came to see what was happening over the last several days as a very large threat. One question I had for you, as you were talking about, as the current giant crop of sunspots rotates so that it's facing us, it raises questions about how long the sun's day is. Mm. That is to say, how long does it take to fully rotate once on its axis? I feel like it's like 4 weeks or something.
Yep.
In which case, it's coming into full blast on Earth space. And obviously sunspots can show up, I assume, anywhere on the sun, but this particular cluster is not expected to totally disappear anytime soon, but once it is no longer facing Earth, we have at least another 3.5 weeks or so before it circles around again and
yep.
is putting Earth at any immediate risk.
So it takes 2 weeks for something to cross the face of the sun that we see. So we get an indication of it as it comes around the edge, it moves towards center disk, which is where it poses a big threat, and then
yep.
it moves out. At this moment, we on Earth are in danger because we have a CME coming from an eruption a couple days ago. But the sunspot itself, even if it were to emit a much larger X-class flare, most of it would not hit us because
yeah.
it is already facing away. It's still visible, but it's already facing away. That only gets better for the next, week. It will be out of view. It can do anything it wants on the far side, doesn't affect us. And then it will come back around. It may have broken up. It may have calmed down. in the last time we had a big solar storm, which was back in May, was it?
May of 2024.
May of 2024, mm-hmm. It did come back around. The monster cluster of sunspots came back around the other side. So anyway, that can happen too.
Not relevant to what we're currently talking about, but the periodicity, the length of the sun's day being 4 weeks-ish, is remarkably similar to the length of the moon's orbit around the Earth. Is that a coincidence or not, I wonder?
I think it's likely to be a coincidence, but it's certainly conspicuous.
I mean, I'd certainly want to know, you know, it's not the only satellite in the solar system.
Right, that's
so there's
it.
Lots of other satellites with lots of other, I guess it's their year. Ish. It's not. Yep. It's hard to know exactly what to call it when I guess you would still call it. I think it's a year. However long it takes for you to orbit around the thing that you are most closely orbiting around, because the moon is also orbiting around.
So the
around
lunar year is a month.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But then if the sun's day is a month, if the sun's day is 28 days, and a lunar year is 28 days, Earth days. That's an interesting coincidence, if that's all it is.
Yep. It is an interesting coincidence, and I, you know, who knows what we will ultimately know about this system. It's really fascinating. The more I've delved into it, the more interesting it was. I used to puzzle over the 11-year solar cycle and just think, okay, solar system's weird. It's not weird, of course.
Yeah,
it makes sense.
Well, I wonder. I mean, so this question, I bet most good astronomers have thought about, but If it's a coincidence, if the sun's day and the moon's orbit around the Earth being the same length just happened to be, that might then have set the conditions for the moon to be tidally locked. That it is that its day length and it's effectively a year length of the same length of time, but
yep.
it is moving itself at the same rate as the sun is moving itself on its axis.
Well, I am definitely going to pursue the answer to this question because it's a really, really good one. All right. So is that
clearly
a real-time
view
for?
I think so. Strong geomagnetic storm levels. It's switching.
It looks to be real-time?
Yeah, it does.
Okay. Interesting. All right.
Strong geomagnetic storm levels now. Severe still expected.
Okay. Well... All right, that's something to keep your eye on. What yeah. Heather is now looking at, the M-null spiral is a model. Oh, it's now gone. There
yeah,
it is.
I guess I do have, I am in control. Was that what you wanted me to look at? What?
The other one.
This one?
Yeah, so that spiral is a model. When a CME happens, it is modeled, I think, by NOAA as to how quickly it's moving, how dense it is, what direction it's going, how it will interact with other ejections and the solar wind. And these models, you know,
yeah,
so you generate that model and then you find out in real time whether or not the model was accurate. So when we say that experts were surprised at the rate of the arrival of one of these CMEs, that it came early and that actually gave the magnetic field a chance to build back up before right. the next one hit. That's a result of that particular model having been inaccurate. Right. They're pretty good, but they're far from perfect.